Good evening. I'm Jonathan Fanton, president of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and it's my pleasure to call to order the 2048th stated meeting of the American Academy. Tonight's program is also our annual Morton Mandel public lecture, made possible through the generosity of the Jack, Joseph, and Morton Mandel Foundation. I think most people here know the Academy was founded in 1780 by John Adams and James Bowdoin and John Hancock and other leaders who helped establish the United States. In the midst of the Revolution, they believed the key to America's long-term strength and survival was, and this is in the words of our charter, to cultivate every art and science which may tend to advance the interest, honor, dignity, and happiness of a free, independent, and virtuous people. From the very beginning, the Academy's purpose has not been simply to honor excellence in a broad range of disciplines and professions, though that we do. Its members also conduct studies of critical policy issues and debate the most pressing questions of the day. Let me share just a couple examples to bring you up to date on what your Academy is doing. A recent Academy report entitled Restoring the Foundation encourages a greater emphasis on long-range planning in the area of science and engineering. It urges funders and policymakers to provide more support for basic research that may not yield immediate results but may ultimately prove to be transformative. Several of the report's recommendations found their way into legislation that was introduced by both the Senate and the House earlier this year. And that legislation reaffirms the value of peer review. It reduces administrative burdens for university researchers and advocates for improving STEM education. I'm happy to say both houses have now agreed on the same language, and it's very likely that this will be law before the end of the year. The Academy also has a deep interest in higher education. Last spring, we released our Lincoln Report that's been looking at the challenges faced by public research universities as states sharply reduce their funding. Another commission is underway looking at how Americans receive their post-secondary education, and not just looking at elite schools, but community colleges, for-profit schools, and online providers. Rising costs, how students finance their education, challenges of fair access to students from diverse backgrounds, and the match between what we teach and the world in which these young people are going to live and work 20 years hence are all central topics. Not all the Academy's work comes in the form of commissions or long-term projects. Last year, we created an exploratory fund to enable members like you, to get together with other members and experts to talk about issues that are on your mind. Some could have a short-term policy focus, but others may be peering over the horizon or addressing more academic issues like preserving intellectual legacies in a digital age. Our first meeting was organized by John Levy, who chairs the Legal Services Corporation, and he's concerned about how poorly our justice system works for low-income Americans. 80% of low-income people who go to a legal services office for help get turned away. And now, happily, we have a working group that's been formed to develop a plan to address that problem. Other exploratory meetings are looking at the growing disconnect between global and area studies, the future of jazz, and the need for a new international norm on the responsibility to protect cultural heritage in conflict zones. There are more, but that gives you a sense that there's a wide range here, and you're encouraged simply to write a letter with an idea if you want to talk to us about it. And now, this evening's program has a particular relevance to a new Academy initiative we call the Public Face of Science, which is examining the complex and evolving relationship between science and the public. This multi-year project will examine how public trust or mistrust in science is shaped by individual experiences, beliefs, exposure to media reports on scientific discoveries, and other factors. Activities will include roundtable discussions with Academy members and practicing journalists, as well as a series of shorter studies on how scientists are consulted during specific public policy decisions, for example, testifying in court cases or giving advice when there's a natural disaster. We held our first workshop in June at the Academy, chaired by Geneva Overholzer. Participants explored the issues that lie at the heart of public support for science and the scientific process, such as the need to improve how science is communicated to the public and how public attitudes are shaped by encounters with science that occur outside of the formal classroom setting, for example, museum visits, science festivals, and more. Tonight's conversation relates to these themes, and we're fortunate to have with us two Academy members, Alan Alda and Diane Ackerman, who've done as much as anyone to promote the communication of science through different media. Our moderator, Geneva Overholzer, will provide a fuller introduction to their respective bodies of work, but with their permission, I'd like to read two passages from their letters of acceptance. You remember those, letters of acceptance. Alan wrote, and I quote, "I'm particularly happy to be included in a list of both scientists and artists because I wish for our country both the highest experience of art and the deepest possible understanding of science. By the greatest number of our citizens, I believe that our souls and our very existence depend on it." And calling herself a literary writer who's always been enthralled by the sciences, Diane wrote, and I quote, "In my mind's eye, I'm picturing the Academy as a Venetian lagoon with many Escher-like bridges spanning the disciplines on which artists and scientists all mingle." Well, I'm particularly drawn to the image of Escher-like bridges connecting the disciplines, not just for the visual force of Diane's words, but for the idea that the arts and the sciences stand on equal footing, and that as humankind climbs ever higher in its aspirations, we must pass repeatedly through these two interconnected worlds. The key to interconnection, of course, is communication, and in that spirit, I'm pleased to introduce tonight's moderator and journalist and award-winning news editor, Geneva Overholzer. Geneva has been a fellow of the American Academy since 2001, and is the co-chair of our Public Face of Science initiative. She currently is a senior fellow at both the Democracy Fund and the Center for Communication Leadership and Policy, having been director of the USC Annenberg School of Journalism before. She's an award-winning editor with the Des Moines Register from 1988 to 95, during which time the paper won a Pulitzer Prize for public service. So, Geneva, take it away.